The union budget, which was presented earlier today by the finance minister, was the longest speech that a finance minister has delivered in recent times. It contained a lot of provisions with regard to development of the economy, which everybody was looking at and with bated breath. But more important, I'm sure what you want to hear from me, are the breathtaking changes which the finance minister spoke about in the field of taxes. I must tell you that while only half an hour of her speech was devoted to part B, which contains the tax provisions, but the number of changes that have been proposed by the finance minister on the side of tax is absolutely breathtaking. It would be actually not even practicable to cover all the changes in a couple of hours. But let me in the next few minutes tell you what are those key changes which you need to be alive of, because those changes are going to impact you on a day-to-day basis. The first set of changes, if I may talk to you about, are the changes in relation to what is the ambit of a taxable income of a person, who is a resident of India, who is a non-resident. And in the sphere of non-resident, what the finance minister has done is to reduce the period for which a person can stay in India to qualify to be a resident from 182 days to 120 days. To put it conversely, earlier a person could become a non-resident if a person was out of the country for 182 days or more, subject of course to fulfilling certain other conditions. Now that period has been reduced to 120 days, meaning you can be in India only for 120 days. You have to be 240 days outside the country if you have to qualify to be a non-resident. More important, there is a fundamental change in the basis of taxation, which in some sense is a la what we see in USA. As you know, in USA, if you are a citizen of USA or you are a green card holder, then you are liable to tax in the USA on your global income. In the same way, it has now been provided that if you are a citizen of India, but you are staying overseas, then you will still be regarded as a resident of India if you are not taxable in that other country on the basis of your domicile, residence or any other similar criteria. Now, there are Indians who have been living overseas and maybe for many, many years, and they may or may not be liable to tax in those countries because those countries don't have a tax regime. The one place which immediately comes to mind is UAE, the other is Bahrain, although those places are continuing to shrink and shrink. But the fact is that today there are places where you could be a resident and not be liable to income tax. You could of course be paying other taxes in that country but not be paying income tax. Potentially, in a situation like that, a person could be regarded as a resident of India and could be liable to tax on a global income. Obviously, again, if that income of the person is not in the form of individual income but is held through a company, different consequences may happen. But this is a very, very fundamental, a very broad change. There are similar changes which have been brought about in the case of companies. So, for example, it is provided that to be eligible to the benefits of a tax treaty, if you are a resident of a country with which India has got a tax treaty, then you should not be in that country only for the purpose of treaty shopping. This is sort of aligning India's position with the multilateral instrument which India has signed as a part of the OECD BEPS program. We then have a series of other amendments in relation to dividend distribution tax. And again, these are going to impact us on a day-to-day basis, because if you are a shareholder in any company, until now you received the dividends without paying any taxes in your hands because the dividend was taxed in the hands of the paying company. Now the paying company can distribute the dividend without having to pay a distribution tax, which was in the region of 20%. But the person receiving the dividend would be liable to tax in his own hands on account of the dividend which has been received. So clearly one can see the impact out here. If you are a resident whose effective rate of tax is less than 20%, then you will be far better off, because the tax which was being paid by the company would presumably pay it out and you would receive a higher dividend, and that dividend you would be taxed at less than 20%, so you are better off. But if your effective rate of tax is more than 20%, then you would end up paying a higher rate of tax. And assuming that you go to the highest maximum marginal rate, which including surcharge is 43%, then you would end up paying a 43% tax compared to the 20% tax which would have been paid by the company. But that's so far as individual is concerned. Let's look at how promoters normally structure their investments into a company. You could be holding shares in a company through a holding company vehicle or through a trust or through an LLP. Different consequences arise now compared to what were the consequences earlier. Earlier, it didn't matter in what form and shape you held the equity of a company, because the company paid the tax and you didn't have to worry. Now, for example, if you get it as an LLP, there is a different rate of tax. If you get it through a trust, there is a different rate of tax. If you are holding it individually, there is a different rate of tax. And the companies will now be forced to relook at the way in which they hold shares. Promoters will need to relook at this very, very carefully. A very, very significant change indeed. Then we have another series of changes which have come about, which is in the context of disputes. And while I'm not going to elaborate on this video, the entire set of changes, but what the government is trying here to do is to say that if you have a dispute and you are in litigation on that dispute, instead of continuing to litigate, you have an option of agreeing to settle that dispute by paying the principal amount of taxes. You don't have to pay interest, you don't have to pay penalty. You have a very, very short window in which to make that decision, which is 31st March. And you could make the decision after 31st March, but up to 30th June on payment of interest. But let's just first stick to what is at hand, which is the 31st March date. You could find this scheme attractive in many, many cases. So for example, if you are in dispute because there was a particular position in law which you took, and then there are subsequent Supreme Court decisions or other decisions which cast a doubt on it, you might come back and say, I might as well settle the dispute because I now don't have to pay interest and penalty. Look at another set of situation. You are in litigation, and litigation in India is a very, very long drawn affair. So you are going to litigate for 10, 12, 15 years, and the interest keeps on mounting. And that interest could be substantially in excess of the amount of taxes. And you go back and say, well, I do not know whether I want to continue litigating. Why do I not simply make the payment of taxes and forget it, because I don't have to pay interest now, I don't have to pay penalty. If you are a foreign company, you might come back and say, I am getting credit for the interest which I did, a tax which I pay in India in a foreign country, I might as well pay and forget it. Breathtaking changes, far-reaching changes. At Dhruva, we will send out to you separate videos on each aspect of these changes detailing. And I'm sure you will find that very, very educative, very, very illuminative. I must say overall that the budget is forward-looking. Some of these changes may seem to be widening the base of tax, but this is where the world is moving to globally, and India is becoming part of that entire change rather than lagging behind. Thank you for watching this video, and we look forward to getting more and more to you. Thank you.